worship here today at Bethel Mobile, and it's good to have you all here on this. It's going to be kind of a toasty one today. Is that what it's feeling like out there? I got here pretty early this morning. Is it kind of the heat coming up, or are we getting kind of pleasant? No. Okay, well, whatever. But it's great to be together as God's people today. We have a special treat today. After the worship service, we typically go out here into the commons area. We have cookies and coffee. Today, Jessica and Josh Frybrink are serving us beer floats. So, beer floats on a July day. So, after church this morning, come on out here to the commons, grab your root beer float. There will be coffee and lemonade there as well. Hang out around the tables and just enjoy being together as God's people. It's kind of a little bit of a farewell party to this place for the next couple of weeks. We have a special opportunity to kick Bethel Mobile into a different gear for the next 2 weeks. I just received word this past week that we will need to be out of the high school for the next 2 weeks. We were thinking it was just going to be on the 30th, but we need to be out of here on the 23rd and the 30th. We have a big celebration planned for the 30th on the Lot of Faith. We're going to be partaking of communion that day. We're going to have a cookout that day. We're going to have a tent on the grounds. There's a lot of good pieces falling into place for worship service on the Lot of Faith on the 30th. Next week, however, we're going to be in the Wansink Center. Thankfully, the Lord had the Wansink Center available for us when we got the word that we needed to vacate the high school for next week. So that is where we will be. Please spread the word. We're going to send out an announcement about this via email. We'll put signs on the doors and that kind of thing. But keep it in your mind. We're going to be in the Wansink Center for our worship next week, and once again, we will see that Jesus will be there with us, that we will experience His presence and His Spirit wherever we are. That is what we are learning through this time where we are Bethel Mobile, so please do keep that in mind. Also, please keep in mind to be praying for Casey Henke. We sent out the email late Friday night about an accident that he was involved with on his motorcycle. He had a number of fractures that are going to require surgery. He's going to be going through surgery tomorrow, and then probably another one later on in the week. But please keep Casey, Johanna, and their four girls in your prayers as they walk through this time of Casey healing from this injury. Thankfully, his life was spared, and we are praying for his healing as they move through this time. So let's stand and greet one another. Let's welcome each other to church today, and you're ready to worship our great blessed God.
About our God who saves. Yeah. that saves, and because of that, we bless his name. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Thank you.
our youth ministry director to come up here and join me. Got some exciting days coming for the youth ministry of Bethel. And Sam's going to share just a little bit about that. Can you give me a mic?
Good morning.
So this coming Friday, we're taking a group of high school kids and some of our leaders to go to the annual Rocky Mountain High retreat down in Estes Park, Colorado. It's actually not annual, it's every 3 years, but yeah, we're going, leaving this Friday. So yeah, Rocky Mountain High is, I've never actually been there, so I don't really know all the details about it. But it's in the mountains, so it has to be cool, I think. And there's different bands that are going to be there to lead us in worship. There's different speakers that are going to be there to kind of share with us. There's a bunch of free time to hang out. There's some different recreational activities you can do, from hiking a mountain to water rafting down a river and all different kinds of cool stuff. So for you guys, I want to encourage you guys to be a part of this experience with us, not only through prayer. I think just being in the mountains and talking about God can be an impactful experience for a lot of kids. But we also need your prayers for God to be at work during this whole weekend while we're there. Prayers for safety, prayers for softened hearts and open ears, just to really receive God's Spirit while we are there for the weekend. And then there's another way you can be involved. I put a bunch of these sheets in the back of the church. It looks like this. And it talks about a way that you can watch our sessions online. They're Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, morning and night, the times are on the sheet here. You can also watch all of them once we're done, which will be next week, or not next week, Wednesday the 26th is when we come back. So after that, you'll be able to watch all of our sessions online. So through prayer, watching the videos online, that's how you can be kind of involved with our trip. And I also encourage you, just when we get back, just to really ask the kids about their experience. As a body, as a church body, I want you guys to stay connected with the kids in that way, and I think there's a few different ways you can do that through this trip. So, awesome. So, people are going out on Bethel's bus?
Yes.
How many people in the bus?
We got our group going, which is, I think, 18 or 19. And then we're also taking a group from Ironton Reformed Church with it, which is 7 people, I think. So, we'll have almost 30 people on the bus.
Right, cool, awesome. So how about we have the people that are going to be going to Rocky, both students and leaders. Would you guys stand up, please? All right, if you are near one of these folks, would you just either, if you can, place a hand on them, extend your hand toward them, and we're going to pray over this trip and the students that are here and the leaders that are here this morning, but also those that will be going along on the trip when they join as we go along. Libby, you're part of it too, right? I'll take Sam. Okay. All right, let's pray together. Father, we are so grateful for this awesome opportunity that the young people of our church and the leaders that have given of themselves and their time are going to have as they journey to Colorado, the beauty of your creation, to experience an amazing event in the mountains. May the mountains declare your glory, may this event declare your glory, and may it draw the hearts and the minds of the students and the leaders to you, giving you great glory in their spirits. Father, we ask for your safety as they travel. Surround the bus with your guardian angels, watch over the drivers, and may there be a great spirit as they travel together. We also pray, Father, that your spirit will be at work in this time, and that you will do what you want to do in the lives of the people that are there. We pray for a blessing on this whole event, Father, on the musicians and the speakers that will come. We pray for safety, too, in the special activities that will take place. Your will be done, Father, and we look forward to hearing of the ways that you have touched lives and the impact that this will make on them. We thank you for Sam, for his leadership, for each one of our volunteer leaders as well, for their willingness to pour their lives into the lives of our high school students. We give you all praise and glory, Father. We commit this to you in your care and keeping, your will. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. God bless you guys. We'll be praying for you. You leave on Friday, right, Sam?
Friday.
Awesome. Friday evening. It's a day of prayer. And let's continue in prayer right now. Father, we have just sung how you are our peace, how you are our strength. In you we find everything that we need. We belong to you, Father. When we know Jesus as our Savior, we have everything, everything we could possibly need. Thank you for the peace, the strength that that gives us. Thank you for the joy and the contentment that that can fill our hearts with, even in the middle of life's challenges and struggles. We are grateful that you are here with us today, Father. The presence of your Holy Spirit is here with us. We open ourselves up to you and ask, Holy Spirit, that you will fill this place, that you'll be at work in each one of us in just the way that we need to experience you today. You know best, Father, and so we open ourselves to your good pleasure and will to do that in our lives and accomplish in us what you want to today. And in this all, in all of this time, Father, that we spend together, may the name of Jesus be lifted up, may you be praised and worshiped as our great God. May we indeed say, blessed be the name of the Lord because of all that you have done for us, all you will do for us. We're grateful that we can be the people of Bethel here, Father, that no matter where we are, that your hand, that your spirit is with us, and that your hand is on us, and that you are guiding us, and that you are filling us. We thank you for the sweet spirit of fellowship that is here in this place. Father, we ask for your blessing in the next couple of weeks as we engage in a little bit more of that land between that we are involved in now, as we become Bethel a little bit more mobile. And we pray that you will prepare the way before us. We thank you for the Wanson Center that is provided for us next week. We know that your spirit is going to be there no matter where we are, Father. That is, we will experience you and your spirit, the presence of Jesus among us, and your name be lifted up in that place. And Father, we also pray for this, the service that will take place in a lot of faith in a couple of weeks. Prepare the way there. May a sweet, special spirit fill that time as well. Father, we are grateful for the way that you faithfully led and blessed, guided, and we ask you to continue to do that. We ask for your wisdom. We ask for your direction and discernment. Father, you are so good, and we sense your hand in us, working through us, and we are grateful, and we want to give you glory. May we be people that indeed say the Lord has done great things for them. May people see and say the Lord has done great things for them and for us, Father. We just are so glad to be your people. Today, Father, we pray especially for Casey Hanke. We pray for your healing touch in his body. Thank you for sparing his life. We ask, Father, that you bless the surgeons, that you bless all those who care for him, that healing will be able to take place, and that you'll move Casey through this time for healing and recovery with your strength and your presence. We pray for Johanna and the girls. We ask for your grace to be poured out on his family during this difficult time that they are walking through right now. Help us as a congregation to support and encourage and bless them as well. Father, we ask that you will also be with those who need you in special ways, who are going through transitions in their lives. We continue to pray for the island constant. Thank you for the transition that you're helping her through. We also pray, Father, for people that are going through testing and other things in this coming week. We continue to pray for Jerry Hoffmeyer's recovery, healing, and the aftermath of his surgery. We pray, Father, that you'll heal him and help him with the therapy that he has to go through. Feeling better and stronger very soon. We ask you to give him grace and patience as he moves through this time too. Father, we are grateful to be your people. We are grateful for all the things, the blessings that you pour into our lives. We pray this today in Jesus' name with thanksgiving. Amen. We're going to receive our morning offering. As the offerings received, the praise team will continue to lead us in worship. Give with a generous and joyful worshiping heart. Out of all that God has given to us, this is a way to express our trust in Him, to express our worship and praise to Him. May His name be glorified as we give.
Like a
Father, thank you that we can sing those words. Thank you that today we can look at a passage in Scripture that really those words are based on. We ask that you'll open our hearts, our spirits, to what you want to say to us today. Father, I ask for the anointing of your Holy Spirit on me as I share. May your words be spoken this morning. May your presence be felt. May the truth of your word, the truth about Jesus, be very, very much seen by our spirits today in this time. We give this to you. I ask you to work in Jesus' name. Amen. I think among all the great hymns, that's one of my top three. I love it as well. I think it speaks such great truth, and it is such a, sometimes we just need to preach to our souls as well. It's okay. It's good. Because God is with us as well as my soul. Today we continue our series of messages based on Philippians. I was looking back, as I've been going through this, as I write these in my computer, I Philippians, what's the secret? And then I put just a number behind it. This is sermon number 10 on this great book. As we've been looking through this, I thought I would probably do maybe 5. And here we are at 10. This is such a rich book, and we've been spending the last while looking at it and just digging into what God is saying through Paul to the Philippian Christians and what he's been saying to us. And as we've been looking at this book, we've been asking the question, what's Paul's secret? What's the secret to his joy, his peace, his contentment, his courage, his ability to say, it is well with my soul, in the face of incredible challenges, incredible persecution sometimes, even suffering? Paul is always filled with this joy, this contentment. And we've been asking, what is the secret? Well, today, we've been seeing that as we've been looking at it, but today Paul actually mentions the secret. He actually uses that word. We've been asking, what's the secret? But Paul has never actually used this word until today with our passage that we find in Philippians chapter 4. We're going to begin at verse 10 of Philippians 4 today. Philippians 4, verses 10 through 13 is what we're going to focus on today. Paul says, I rejoice greatly in the Lord that at last you have renewed your concern for me. Indeed, you have been concerned, but you had no opportunity to show it. I'm not saying this because I am in need, for I have learned to be content whatever the circumstances. I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. I can do everything through him who gives me strength. So, as this section of Philippians opens, what is Paul talking about here at the beginning? In verse 10, when he says, I rejoice greatly in the Lord that you at last have renewed your concern for me. Indeed, you have been concerned, but you had no opportunity to show it. What's he talking about? I want to just bring you back to the beginning of this sermon series. When we talked about the occasion that prompted Paul to write this letter to the Philippians, Paul is under house arrest in Rome. He's being held as a prisoner until he can stand trial before Caesar. Being held, a Roman guard is with him all the time, and the Philippian Christians had heard about Paul's situation, and they decided that they wanted to do something to help Paul, and they sent Epaphroditus. Remember we talked about Epaphroditus, Paul mentions him in Philippians 2, they sent Epaphroditus to Rome with a gift of financial support and maybe some other things as well to help meet Paul's needs while he's under house arrest here in Rome. It's not like our prison system where the prisoners, you know, we as taxpayers provide for all their needs. A prisoner in that day had to fend for themselves. They didn't get 3 squares a day served by the prison cooks. They had to get their own food. They had to take care of their own needs. And some prisoners just simply languished because they had no one to help them. Well, the Philippian Christians are doing some of that for Paul, helping to provide for his needs. And so they sent this gift with Epaphroditus, and now Paul is sending Epaphroditus back to Philippi with this letter for the Philippians. And this letter is meant to tell the Philippian Christians how Paul is doing. He wants to let them know how things are going with him, and he does a lot of that in chapter 1, and we see some of the things that he talks about in the early chapters, and really more so, rather than just letting the Philippians know how he's doing, this letter is also one in which Paul is encouraging the Philippians in their faith. He's encouraging them to grow in their spiritual maturity, becoming more and more like Jesus. He's encouraging them to stand firm in fearless unity in face of the challenges and the struggles that Epaphroditus told him about. And he's doing this. He's doing this all through this letter by sharing his own attitude, how he is approaching his situation, the spirit that he goes through, the things that he's dealing with. He's sharing that with the Philippian Christians as a means of encouraging them and helping them understand that it's Paul's relationship with Jesus that sustains him. It's his relationship with Jesus that strengthens him. And it's living a certain way that helps him experience his joy. We've been talking about that seems to be Paul's secret. And as he's done this, as he shared about his own attitude, he's held up himself as a role model and an example. Follow my example, even says to the Philippians. He's also held up Timothy and Epaphroditus as examples for them to follow us as people who selflessly serve others with the love of Christ and continue to trust Jesus. Epaphroditus, he says in chapter 2, almost died for the sake of the gospel. And Paul holds them up as an example. And more, most importantly and ultimately, Paul also holds up Jesus himself as an example for the Philippians to follow. You recall that great passage in Philippians chapter 2. So all throughout this letter, Paul is sharing these things and talking about these things in a way that will help the Philippians grow in their spiritual maturity and stand firm in fearless unity. And now here at the end of the letter, Paul gets to something that we would have probably put at the beginning. If you and I were writing this letter, this might have been the very first thing we mentioned, especially in light of that gift that came with Epaphroditus. But this doesn't come till way at the end of this letter of Philippians. Paul thanks them for their thoughtful and generous gift. 4 chapters into the letter, and he didn't write the letter with chapters, it's just how we break it up, but it's way toward the end. Here's where he finally says, expresses his gratitude. That's what he's talking about here when he says that he rejoices greatly in the Lord about them renewing their concern for him. That's what he's talking about, is this gift. He's rejoicing that they've been able to do something to tangibly express their concern and the care that they have felt for Paul all this time. They just haven't had an opportunity to show it. Now, at last, Epaphroditus has been able to get to the Philippians, or get to Paul from the Philippians, and he's been able to express their love and care for Paul by bringing this gift and probably by encouraging him and sharing some things with him as well. So if you and I were writing this letter, we would have probably started with that. I rejoice greatly in the gift that you've been able to send me. I rejoice greatly that you've renewed your concern for me and that Epaphroditus has shown up with this gift. We would have started this letter with a huge thank you. Thank you. But Paul doesn't. He doesn't do that. And it's not because he's not grateful. He definitely is grateful, and he expresses his gratitude in the verses that we're going to look at next week. But still, Paul waits to talk about their gift until way at the end of the letter, almost like it's a, oh, by the way, thanks. That kind of a thing. And I think by doing that, it's another way that Paul shows the Philippian Christians and us one of the keys to Paul's secret. It shows us once again how Paul understands the infinite worth and glory of Jesus. Look at what he says here. He immediately points out that he's not saying he rejoices about their gift because it meets a need that he was concerned about.
He says, I'm not saying this because I am in need. And later on, he'll say why he rejoices in their gift in the verses that we'll look at next week. But right here he says, I'm not rejoicing because I'm in need. It's not because I was desperately in need of it and was hoping for it. Oh, wow, I finally got here, and now he's rejoicing. He says, that wasn't how I was feeling at all. And so many words by saying, not because I'm in need, in so many words he's saying that he's just fine without their gift. He says, for I have learned to be content whatever the circumstances. Like he's saying, I don't really need it, but I am just fine with or without the gift. I have learned to be content, whatever the circumstances. And Paul isn't saying this as someone who has only had things go well for him. You know, it's kind of easy to say, yeah, I'm content. We've got as much money in the checkbook as we need to pay our bills. We've got plenty of food in the refrigerator. We have good health. All things are going well. Oh, yeah, I'm content. It's easy to say it then. But Paul isn't saying this just because things are going well for him and that he's only had things go well for him. He doesn't say I've learned to be content in all circumstances because all his circumstances have been great. Paul has been in some pretty awful circumstances. He says, I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I've been well-fed, and I've been hungry. I've lived in plenty, and I've lived in want. And the Philippian Christians knew that about Paul. They knew it very well. In Acts chapter 16, we read how it was in their very own city, in Philippi, where they saw Paul and Silas attacked, stripped, beaten, severely flogged, and thrown into prison. And there, they were in the inner dungeon. They weren't just, they were, I don't know what that was, but it says they were in the inner dungeon with their feet in stocks. What were they doing? Acts 16:25 says they were praying and singing hymns to God. That's an astounding picture. And that's what the Philippian Christians remembered. So when Paul says, I've learned to be content in any and all circumstances, they knew what he was talking about, that it wasn't just good things. Talk about being in need, being in want. It doesn't get a lot worse than what Paul and Silas were experiencing there in that prison with their backs all bloody, beat up, and their feet sitting in stocks. You can imagine how uncomfortable. And here they were singing because Paul knew a secret. He knew the secret to being content no matter what. He says, I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation. What's the secret? Verse 13, I can do everything through him who gives me the strength. Other versions say, I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. The secret is Jesus. The secret is Jesus and understanding his infinite worth and glory and all that he is for anyone who belongs to him. Paul knew that no matter what happened to him, no matter what his circumstances were, nothing could ever change the fact that he belonged to and was in relationship with the most important, most valuable, most glorious, most powerful, most loving being in the whole universe, and that nothing could change that. That's what filled his spirit with contentment and strength. Not just strength. You know, the verse says, I can do all things, I can do everything through him who gives me strength, but Paul is talking about contentment. So this connection with Jesus doesn't just give him strength, but it gives him contentment. And I think there's a nuance here that we need to understand. You know, usually we think about, I can do all things through him who strengthens me, through him who gives me strength. And Paul says he can do everything. the good things and even the hard things through him who gives me strength. He says, in the middle of all the hardships and challenges he faced, and in the middle of the times when things are going wonderfully, Paul knew and sensed Jesus giving him strength, but he also knew contentment, no matter what. And I think that's different and more important than strength. That contentment is different than just strength. Let me try and tell you what I mean here. I think it's what we see in Paul when he's singing in the Philippian jail. I think it's what we see in Paul when he talks about rejoicing, even when he's in prison in Rome, how he starts his letter out with that. He's rejoicing. Those are things that give us a picture of contentment in Paul. When I think about having strength in those situations, being in prison or whatever, when I think about strength, I think about being able to just hang on and endure, you know, gritting your teeth and doing what you can to take what's coming next. You know, you can picture after going through what Paul went through there in Philippi, and he's sitting there in the jail like, just give me strength, Lord. Just give me strength to make it through. Or when he's sitting there in the under house arrest in Rome, like, how many more days? He wouldn't look at his watch. You know, my watch. Paul wouldn't look at his sundial, you know, like the Flintstones or whatever. But you know, looking at a calendar, how many more days? How many more days? Oh, it's another day. Give me strength, Lord. Give me strength to hang on, to endure. That's what the sense of having Jesus give him strength. And I know that Paul was doing those things in the strength that Jesus was giving him. But he was also doing it with singing and rejoicing. And I think that comes from contentment. That speaks to the contentment that Paul is giving. Not just the strength, get me through, but I am good. I am fine. All is okay with me. And that's what Paul ultimately had in all of these situations, is contentment. He wasn't just strong. He was content because of Jesus. He was content because he knew that no matter what, no matter how deprived he was connected to the greatest treasure in all the universe, Jesus Christ. He is the greatest treasure in all the universe. That's why Paul could say that he considered everything that may seem valuable to us as human beings, he considers all of that loss. He even calls it rubbish compared to the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. Remember how he said that in Philippians 3? Compared to knowing Jesus, none of that other stuff matters to the Philippians, whatever you want to call it. And it's why he could say in Philippians chapter 1, for me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. Paul knew that even if he was in such a state of need or hunger or want, that he even lost his life. I mean, how much more extreme can you get when it comes to being in need, being in want? That you lose your very life. Paul, even at that point, could say, for me to live is Christ, to die is gain. Even if it got to that point, he would still have the greatest treasure of all, and that's Jesus. That filled him not just with strength, but contentment. It filled him with such peace and abiding joy that no matter what was going on, he was fine. Whether the Philippians sent him money or not, whether he got out of jail or not, whether he was allowed to live or was put to death, he was fine, because he would never be separated from Jesus. And I think that the way Paul acknowledges the Philippians' gift to him, once again, points us to the truth of the infinite worth and glory of Jesus. And the way that understanding that can fill us with joy and contentment. Paul isn't all enamored with their gift because he doesn't really need it. He has all that he has in Jesus. that's what he wants for the Philippians to see. That's what he wants us to see. That's what we need to see. We get so caught up in the things of this life, and we so often don't experience this contentment that we see in Paul because we forget about the greatest treasure that is really ours. Life has some wonderful and beautiful times, and it has some really hard and awful times. We can be content in any of those. Life has times when we have more than enough and times when we can barely get by. Life has times when we are filled with success and great achievement, we're on top of the world, and life has times when we are filled with failure, and all we deal with seems to be a struggle. Life has times when we are filled with health and we never even think about doctors and hospitals, and life has times when we wonder if we will ever be healthy again. Life has times where we know exuberant happiness and laughter. We can't hardly stop laughing. And then there's life has times when we wonder if we'll ever be able to stop crying. Life has times when we feel safe, completely safe and secure. And life has times when we're scared out of our wits. Life has times when we feel like I'm just doing great. Living the way I want to live and following Jesus, and life has times where we really mess up. And we do exactly like Paul says in Romans 7, the good that I want to do, I don't do, and the things I don't want to do, that's what I did. We mess up again. You know what? Jesus is always there in every single always there. He says, I will never leave you, I will never forsake you. When I share the gospel with children, I tell them that God makes a promise to you. As close as your hand, I've shared this with you before. He says, I will never leave you. Do that with me. I will never leave you. That's his promise to every one of his children. No matter what you're going through in life, he is always with you. He will never forsake you. He will never leave you. He never leaves us. He is the greatest treasure in all the universe. And when we seek him as our greatest treasure, he will fill us. He will fill us with his contentment. He will fill us with his joy in any and every circumstance. That's the truth. That's the truth that Paul testifies to you. I can do all things through Christ because he's with me. Let's pray. God, please forgive us when we look to other things as our greatest treasure. When we forget the fact that you have given us the greatest treasure in all the universe. When we gave us your son. Forgive us when we try to find the joy and contentment in anything other than Jesus. And help us, we pray. We are weak. Our faith is weak. We're human. We need your Holy Spirit to help us seek Jesus and find in him our greatest treasure. Stir that up in our hearts, Father. Power of your Spirit in us as people, individuals, in us as a church. May Jesus always be our greatest treasure. And we find in him the secret to contentment in any and every circumstance. And we thank you. We thank you that you are always with us, Jesus. You will never leave us. Pray all this in your name, Jesus. I'm glad she's there to keep me in line. I need a benediction. A benediction. Let's stand for the benediction. Oh, people of Bethel, as you go forth.
more than this place, know that the living Christ goes with you. He goes before you to show you the way, behind you to encourage you, alongside you, to befriend you, above you, to watch over you. And he is inside you. The greatest treasure in all the universe lives inside you. He is always to fill you with his power, his peace, his contentment, his strength. Amen. If you need prayer, like elders, pray for you. There will be a couple of elders down here in front after the service. Feel free to come down. They'll be happy to pray with you. Pray for one another out in the Commons area while you're enjoying a root beer float. And we'll see you next week at the Wansink Center. Put that in your brain. That's where we're going to be worshiping. Jesus is going to be there. The Holy Spirit will be there as we gather and worship him.